Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free one-week trial. Playing now on Fandor is a romantic comedy, New York, I Love You, starring Natalie Portman, Ethan Hawke, Andy Garcia, and many more. That's F-A-N-D-O-R.
Hey, everyone. Welcome to, can I say this is the first one, Chris?
Yeah. First one.
The first Fandor video podcast, and we have a really special guest, world famous chef. Can I say world famous chef, Tyler?
Absolutely. Yeah, of course.
The one and only Tyler Florence. Tyler, where are you right now?
I'm in Whitefish Lake, Montana. I'm on vacation with my family. We're here for a week for the 4th of July. We're going to go see some friends at a rodeo tonight, so I'm very excited about that.
Wow. Well, we're here today to talk about the new Anthony Bourdain movie, Roadrunner. Now, we all got a special link to see it early. And first of all, before we get to you, Tyler, Chris, your initial thoughts. What did you think?
You know, it was beautiful. It was a beautiful capturing of his life and the way that he, you know, sort of lived out loud in a number of different ways. And also some of the challenges that he faced over time. And obviously, when you know that the ending is depressing in some ways, that you have to figure out how you get there through the story. And they did a brilliant job of weaving through a bunch of other artists that he worked with. Just commenting on his life, and I just really deeply, deeply enjoyed the movie.
Bryn, we know you love to eat.
did the
movie make you hungry?
Yeah, it did. But the overall takeaway was, man, it was a lot of heart in it, and it was also really sad.
Yeah,
you know.
Yeah. Well, here we are with Tyler, and Tyler, I guess my first question is: first of all, you knew Anthony. Did this film sort of capture the person you knew?
It captured 100% of not only the myth, but the man and the legend and the day-to-day life of who I think was not just a chef here in America. And a lot of people know Anthony Bourdain as a chef or his persona as a chef. He was literally one of the you know, great American writers of our time. I mean, he was in the Valhalla of the Hemingways of the world, and just a really prolific, amazing storyteller. And he just had a very specific focus and a lens, and that was through food. And through that, he really got a chance to tell the stories of the people that are often on the forgotten side of the world, the people who struggle, the people who work hard, their families, their culture, and talk about, you know, just real life situations. And that was kind of hard to watch. That was kind of hard to watch. I mean, we could sit here, and hopefully we're going to talk about this the whole time because it was just such an amazing film. Okay. First of all, thank you for sending that link. It was an absolute epic weekend. I watched it 3 times.
Oh, you did?
And I would just really recommend it because the movie's going to come out in a couple of weeks. I would really recommend everybody watching this. It was just a spectacular story that's, you know, started from the very beginning, because I think a lot of people aren't really sure how Tony kind of came up in the culinary world and what he was doing, and had some real, you know, very credible credentials. I mean, the guy was an amazing chef in his own right. But then that crossover thing I thought was really kind of interesting when it happened, and just to kind of reintroduce his name back out there. So a lot of ways, like my 25-year-old, I have a 25-year-old son, he doesn't really know who Anthony Bourdain is. So sort of he kind of missed that millennial mark. So I think in a way it's a good time to sort of just reintroduce him, you know, and to be able to kind of tell a story again.
Let's jump to a kind of a fun part of the film. There's a moment where Anthony eats the beating heart of a cobra. Do you remember that?
Yeah, I sure do. And I got to tell you, that was that one moment, right, when everybody has sort of the tipping moment in television where they become instant famous, and that was the moment that happened for him. When Tony Bourdain ate the beating heart of a live cobra on television, it set the standard on what extreme, you know, cooking could look and feel like.
So what?
Nobody would ever think about doing that.
What's the craziest thing you've eaten?
Well, I've eaten a lot of weird stuff. I mean,
right.
Anything that walks on 4 legs, I've consumed it at some point in time.
Have you consumed a dog?
I'm not sure, to be honest with you. I was in Korea. I don't know, to be honest with you. I've had some weird shit. I don't know, like, so we were in Costa Rica one time, and we went on this this mission with, you know, the sugar company had a big plantation on there, and they were reintroducing organic sugar into America, and they want to bring some chefs down and, you know, kind of experience it, shoot some stories, mainly for social. So I thought, you know, I'd never been to Costa Rica before. It sounded like a fun time. So we got down there, and we were there for 10 days. And, you know, we sort of soaked up the experience of the sugar plantation in about 4 hours. So I'm like, okay, now another 9 days down here, what are we going to do? It was really, really hot. It was 100% humidity. It's Central America. And then one day they took us to this regional restaurant that's highly acclaimed, and everybody had talked about it. And they said, you got to have this pig, right? This like local indigenous pig that everybody is just kind of crazy about. You got to go get this pig, right? And I'm like, I'm down. I'll eat anything. And I took my assistant down there with me, and she hated my guts after this trip. And I'm about to tell you why. And so we get down there and we get to this restaurant, and so you know the our host said, you know, we'll take, you know, three of the house, you know, five of the house specials. Everybody gets to sort of sample this pig. And then it turns out it wasn't a pig, it was a gigantic like rodent.
Wow.
It was like this gigantic sort of Central American rodent. And you know, and as a guy who has like a familiar palate to what duck tastes like and what goat tastes like and what pigs tastes like, this was an animal I had never experienced before, and I was kind of okay with it, although my assistant
not so much.
spent some time in the bathroom just sort of getting the demons out.
Wait, what rodent does this food that you ate look like?
I gotta let me see if I can pull it up. I'm blanking on the name right now, but there was that, and then Masahiro Morimoto, Iron Chef from Food Network, is a really good friend of mine. So we opened up his restaurant in Philadelphia, the first Morimoto's. And if you guys love sushi, he's just fantastic. One of the greats. Right? We were there one time, and this was maybe a month or two after he just opened his brand new first restaurant, after he left Nobu in New York. And he walked around the restaurant saying hi to people. I was there with a couple of other chefs. And it was, you know, anything else, you know, and we had just like demolished most of the menu. And he was like, anything else you guys want to try? I'm like, you know, what you got? And he goes, huh, okay. So he goes back into the kitchen, and then maybe 10 or 15 minutes, there's two pots that come out. And one is this like really beautiful Japanese crock, right, with a lid, you know, hand-painted ceramic, really, really pretty piece. And it just has rice, and the rice smelled beautiful. It was made with dashi and tasted fantastic. And there was this other small pot that had a handle on it and the lid. And as soon as you lifted it up, the server kind of put a spoon to it, and it was just gelatinous and really thick and kind of spongy, the spongy texture. And the server said, okay, you have to put the spongy texture, something, whatever it was, on top of the rice. You eat it. And when I asked him what it was, he said it was cod sperm.
All right. Wow.
So
I feel like we should have ended with Tyler, because now I'm about to go to Bryn and Chris and say, what's your craziest thing?
What do you do with that? You swallow it. That's what you do.
Yeah, right. Yeah.
But you swallow it. That's what I've had a lot of really weird dining experiences with him. I had dinner with him in New York one time, and he brought out these amuse, like the small little kind of tasting course in the beginning of a, you know, a multi-course degustation menu. And it was two little shot glasses, and one was red and one was clear. And he said it was a turtle bull shot. And so they had fresh turtles in, and then they had gutted the turtles and then drained the turtle blood into a pot and then cured the blood with Russian vodka.
Oh.
So that was in one shot. It was like turtle blood and vodka.
Okay.
And then the other one was a dashi made out of the shells.
Okay.
So I mean, a lot of weird shit.
I got nothing. I mean, a lot of weird shit.
I feel like we've just grossed everyone out.
I got nothing.
Short. You have nothing?
I got nothing.
All right, Bryn, something short and sweet, not as long as time.
Well, Tyler, you know, I'm Vietnamese, so there's a bunch of stuff in my culture that we eat that is a delicacy, like duck blood. They'll drain the blood, and it gets coagulated, and they have a bunch of. Have you tried that before?
I've had rabbit blood. I've had duck blood, sure.
Oh, okay. And then I've had a rat before. It's like field mice, I think it was. Anyway, yeah. So
the Rocky Mountain oysters is as bizarre as I've.
I've eaten a rat. I've eaten a rat before. Okay.
Nothing close to sperm, though.
Yeah, yeah. You definitely... haven't had the
sperm. Brother, you don't know what you're missing.
I guess so.
Don't knock until you try it.
All right, Tyler.
It was pure shock value, but he had a good time, and it's culturally specific, and you know, I just don't know who does that. Really, who's the guy who gets that out? That was my thing. I just couldn't figure out. You know, what's the process about collecting that?
Well, this is something that Anthony Bourdain probably would have traded on, right?
Get milk from a cow. But how do you get caught sperm from a cow? I just don't know. Like one guy, like a little, I don't know.
The same motions as milking a cow, right? Kind of.
It's little, bro. It's little.
Right. If you're only listening to this podcast, go to the video and look at Tyler's hands as he describes.
It's itty bitty.
Tyler, let's talk about a scene in the film. By the way, we're talking about Anthony Bourdain's new film called Roadrunner. Let's talk about a scene in the film that takes place in Lebanon, where Anthony Bourdain is sitting by a pool watching Israel bomb the hell out of Beirut. Anthony said something profound. He said, "At that moment, I realized the dinner table is not the great leveler. Ultimately, all of us are crushed under the same terrible wheel." Mm. Now, we've known each other for a few years now. You've helped some of the poorest people in the poorest communities in the world. Can you talk about that experience? And do you agree with what Anthony just said?
That was another really big moment where his show gained enormous amount of international traffic and international influence. When Tony Bourdain was, turned into a war correspondent during that conflict with Lebanon, it captured the world's attention. And what he was shooting for the Travel Channel at the time, the reservations, that was just sort of unheard of. And it sounded incredibly dangerous. And there's lots of machismo that kind of comes along with that kind of stuff, especially on his end. But he just rocked it like nobody else and told a real authentic story. And I thought that scared him, right? Because I think that was the first time he realized that this is not what he signed up for, or there was a bigger picture or a bigger story to tell along the way. And I totally agree with that. You know, it feels cliche-ish to say that food is a great equalizer that kind of brings us all together, but it's true. We've helped, through lots of disasters along with World Central Kitchen and our beloved partner with Jose Andreas's amazing NGO. That we get a chance to go and really help fire victims up in Northern California. And it's about to happen again. There's a fire in Butte County right now where almost 10,000 people have been evacuated. And those people have to find some place to go live and eat a good meal, three times a day. So we're in pre-planning on how we're going to deal with that kind of situation. So dealing with the human aspect of food, and then most importantly, not having it, those become real issues that I think we should all be talking about. And when there's like cultural differences that kind of separate you, like that particular scene in the movie, I thought was really interesting, not just him by the pool watching Israel bomb Lebanon, but the feedback loop that CNN was broadcasting at the time, saying that these were all insurrectionists versus people that lived in a community who just didn't want to get bombed in the first place. Mm. So I think, one man's patriot is another man's freedom fighter. And I think depending on the situation, how these things are laid out, it could be spun in a way, especially to like Western audiences, where these everybody's a bad guy. And that's just not the case. So he really just wanted to go deep and go behind, what would be called enemy lines, to really tell an authentic human story about what, their plight and what they were going through, from the Palestinians to, post-Vietnam era Vietnam and South America and all these like really hard, hidden places around the world where food and money and political leadership is hard to come by. And so I thought that was a very pivotal moment in his career, and I'm really glad that they did an amazing job capturing that.
Well, did you want to say something, Chris?
I mean, one of the things that struck me about the movie, it captured those moments, and then it also captured these very personal moments between him and these other creators, especially Josh Homme from Queens of the Stone Age, and David Cho, the graffiti artist, who I have had some experience with because he did the early Facebook offices. And, that the interaction between them and their experiences of the world was, I thought, extraordinarily well captured in the movie too. It was just one of those, the capper of these very human moments and these very human interactions was where this movie just excels.
Tony had some really great friends. Yeah. Tony was a little bit older than me. He was going to turn 65 this year, so I was turned 50. So he's a little bit older than me. So I knew Tony socially. I would see him a handful of times a year at events. The last time I saw him was on the floor for a UFC fight.
Hold on. We're going to save that. We're going to save this story for part two. So
okay, fine, sure. There you go.
Okay, here's the thing. This is our first one, and we're trying to keep these to about 15 minutes. Okay. So this movie has a light side. Anthony Bourdain's new film, Roadrunner, has a very dark side. So this is kind of the light, fun version of the film. And part two, we're going to talk about Anthony Bourdain and the kind of the downward spiral. And that's where we want to hear about how you knew him, how he treated you. And then I'm just going to prepare you for one of the questions, Tyler. Where's your kitchen confidential? Huh?
Well, I'm happy to talk about all that stuff. But I got to tell you, to sort of kind of wrap up the light side of this, I mean, he was a force of nature in so many really positive ways, specifically coming from the food and beverage industry. And as a chef, you know, who just loves culture and loves travel, nobody did it better than him. And for him to go represent us as a force, as a group around the world, and to kind of tell the story of what it's like to work in restaurants, everyone really, really appreciated it, because he spoke the truth, and sometimes the truth hurt, but he spoke the truth, and he was a force to be reckoned with, and I was happy to know him on what level I knew him. I was happy to know him for what it was.
All right, everyone, this is the Fandor Video Podcast. Thank you for tuning in to part one of the Anthony Bourdain movie Roadrunner. Chris, how do we do?
I think we've done great to get part one launched, and you know, part two coming up, the cliffhanger.
All right, we'll be right back, or tune into part two next.
Thanks for tuning in. Today's show is brought to you by Fandor. Sign up online or in the app for a free 1 week trial. Playing now on Fandor is a romantic comedy, New York, I Love You, starring Natalie Portman, Ethan Hawke, Andy Garcia, and many more. That's Fandor. FANDOR.